Welcome to The Exchange. I'm Dan Riley. The Exchange is a streaming internet talk show and podcast of interviews with noteworthy people about their lives, ideas, and current events. This week I sit down with Lee Seong Min, an English-speaking defector from North Korea. During our conversation, Lee talks about his life inside North Korea, how and why he escaped his native country, and his thoughts on the future of one of the world's most secretive, oppressive, and totalitarian governments. As a side note, my apologies for the decreased audio quality of this interview. Lee and I spoke outdoors, outside of a conference in San Francisco, California. Per his request, and for his protection, his picture will not be displayed on the Exchange's website. Welcome to the show. I have a special guest today, Lee Seong Min, a North Korean defector. We're standing outside of a conference in San Francisco, California. And Lee, I just want to first of all say thank you for coming on and talking to us and sharing your fascinating and courageous life story. I'd like to start just by asking you to explain a little bit about your personal background in your life. Where did you grow up? What do you remember from your childhood? And then we can move on and talk about your later life too.
First of all, thank you so much for having me. And introduction about me. I was born in northern part of the North Korea, which is called Hamgyong Province, and then. I defected to South Korea 2010. Currently I'm a student in South Korea.
How does one go about defecting? Was it something that you had thought about for years and finally one day decided now is the time? Or what were the circumstances surrounding you actually being able to defect?
There were a lot of facts that actually pushed me to decide to defect to South Korea. Why live along the border? Actually, I was living in the border city. So, as a child, I had a lot of opportunities to learn more about outside the world. So, it's a lot of factors, it's a corruption of the government, right? And also, the life is much better just across the river in China, right? So it kind of made me very interesting, and it was a very important factor, right?
So primarily the information you would get came from China, and through that information you learned that there was a significantly different way of potentially living outside of North Korea?
Yeah, it was a very important law in deciding to defect. For example, it's foreign media such as South Korea, China, and sometimes American soap operas and movies. It's kind of really such amazing, right? So because it's interesting is among them, South Korean movies and videos were more interesting among North Koreans because since we share the same language and history background. For example, the North Korean government had told us that South Korea was poor and there are a lot of homeless people on the street and children looking for food and transit. But when I watched the South Korean movie, I couldn't see any homeless people. But there is a lot of countless skyscrapers and many cars on the street, facing which rest the South Korean people. It was really amazing. It is really, really important information for us to know at least half of the South Korea, half of the peninsula of South Korea, is much more worth driving. Life was there much better than North Korea.
And is that sentiment, that desire to leave, in your experience, everywhere in North Korea, or was that unique to you? Was that just something that you personally hoped for?
It could be it's one of these special experiences, but interesting is that today is more and more people are being aware of the outside world by seeing some foreign soap operas and movies. So as I watched when I was in North Korea. So, but the interesting is people living in the border cities, yeah. It's close to China, are more likely, you know, be aware of the outside world compared to the people who live inside North Korea.
Right.
Which, you know, lack of information is, something still is a little bit different. Depends on reason, area.
So the weeks leading up or the months leading up to you deciding to actually defect, is the overwhelming sense one of fear because of your knowledge of what potentially could happen to you if it doesn't go well?
Yeah.
And what did you do to prepare? How did you get ready for defecting?
For me, it's a little bit, although I had I wanted to really live in outside the world, like specifically in South Korea, but there was a really important motivation that actually pushed me to defect to South Korea was one of my the siblings. I have another sister,
yeah.
Who left North Korea when she was young, so and then didn't return back to her family in North Korea. So there was almost no way to reunite, you know, together, to live together. So, but good thing was she, you know, got to South Korea earlier first, and then she called back to her family. You know, to me, right? She called back me. So, yeah, that's why we made to South Korea to live together, right?
And so, did she have contacts that potentially could help you get to South Korea and escape North Korea? Was that part of the incentive for you to leave?
Yeah, it was very important fact. And as I said, North Korean society is very corrupt.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't see any some future and hope. You know, North society. This is not a society that emphasizes on qualification, but much more, you know, like if you have a good background, this so-called in Korean 성분, it's if you have born in a good with background family, you're gonna, you know, your future gonna be brighter. But you know, no matter what, how smart you are, how right. You educate yourself, but if you are born with bad backgrounds, there is no hope.
Yeah.
Like, so it's not, it's a justice, you know, not just the society, right?
And what was your background? Did you come from a very bright family or a very successful family that was politically connected?
Probably, if it was a really bright family, I might have still lived in North Korea. Probably it was not the hostile or enemy class, but I think it's a... middle class, or is probably more than middle class, I think.
Right? Yeah, and was there? Did your family or did people, friends of yours growing up, did you know about some of the more secretive and violent elements of North Korean society, the labor camps or the concentration camps that were filled with people who were living there? Was that something that you were aware of, or not particularly?
Yeah, I was aware of the existence of political concentration camp, but I didn't know in detail. But, you know, the people in North Korea, most of the people are aware of the existence of political concentration camp. Mm-hmm. That's why the people would be warning each other in terms of making a comment, which goes against the government. Especially, you know, it's need to be careful in terms of when you comment some politically or especially about leaders, right? So you need to be very careful. I was aware of, yeah.
And was that on your mind when you decided to defect, or did you think it will work and it won't be a problem?
It's more than problem. Of course, I knew, I was aware of. So, you know, when I had to decide to defect to South Korea, I had to be, you know, ready, you know, to kill myself. Like, you know, once I if I was caught, if I had been caught at the moment, right? So I knew the results of a failure of defection would be end up, you know, the sending political concentration camp, or would be publicly, you know, executed as an example. Yeah. So it was.
Talk to me about the day that you did defect and that you did escape. What do you remember? Do you remember waking up that morning? What happened? How did you do it?
For me, it's a little bit. My story is a little bit different from others because I was you know, I involved you know deeply some cross border smuggling. So, which means there is a lot of friends or border guards, right? So relatively easier to cross border. So when I crossed the border, there was a backside. There were seven border guards, armed border guards. They were my friends. So they said something like, they didn't know I was actually going to South Korea, but they believed that I was planning to return back to North Korea next day, right? So I said goodbye, guys. Right? These guys also said goodbye, Seongmin. We're gonna meet you tomorrow. And so, yeah.
So you told. And is that common for people to leave for a day? And I guess you would have said, "I'm going to China for a day, and I'll be back."
Yeah.
Is that something that people who know border guards are able to do? And there's just a trust that they're telling the truth and they'll be back.
Because I used to cross the border, that's why it's possible to me.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean for all people it's possible. Not totally.
Right.
You know, so some people they were shot to death by crossing the border while crossing border. Well, because it's very risky,
right.
You know, without permission, without having the officers you bribe, right? So it's impossible crossing border. Right.
And I guess you just knew or you trusted those seven border guards enough to believe that it would work out okay and that they would let you through. And it sounds like you had done it before.
Yeah. Because I used to cross the border, like for business purposes. So also they thought, you know, they might have thought that I would be the same thing, like crossing back, returning back to North Korea again, right? But it didn't happen.
So you must have had this somewhat planned out in your mind. So you go into China as you had done previously and had done for business, but this time it's the real thing.
Yeah.
So you get into China. What's the first thing you do? I mean, where do you go and how did you deal with being in a foreign country with, I'm imagining, a completely different language?
But good thing was, it's true. But, you know, it's when you see the Chinese people who are living at the border, like it's nearby the Tumon River, like there's a lot of Korean, ethnically Korean Chinese who are able to speak Korean. So there is actually there's no any language barrier because they were able to speak Korean, right? Mm-hmm. So, but what I remember is, the smuggled items actually was a puppy, a dog. So I brought dog into China and sold out at a higher price. And later, with the money I raised, I bought Chinese boots or a carton of cigarettes and smuggled across the river. And sort out, of course, for profit in North Korea. So, yeah.
So just so I have that correct. Yeah. So you brought in goods from North Korea to China, then sold them to make money to then buy cigarettes?
Oh, no. I mean, I bought the carton of the cigarettes in China. Because China, you know, the carton, the cigarettes were cheaper in China, right? So I brought in North Korea and sold out at a more expensive price, right? So, that was one of the items, actually.
Gotcha.
I did.
And so with the Koreans, or with the Chinese who do speak Korean, did you believe that they would help you eventually get to South Korea and that there was a way for you to do that without putting yourself in too much danger?
Actually, the Chinese people who I worked with, we did only the business purposes. Right. They didn't involve in, you know, any way of my defection. But later, when I defected, actually I got received some help from people who I worked with. Kind of is I could able to borrow some Chinese ID, because you know you already might know the Chinese government, they're harsh on, you know, to the North Korean defectors within its territory, right?
Right.
Once they discover, they will repatriate back to North Korea, mm-hmm. where they face harsh punishment, things like that. So since I knew of the you know, situation, so yeah, actually I could able to receive the help from them, you know, by borrowing, receiving some ID of Chinese, right? So I could go through the safely because of the ID, because I had ID, right? So yeah.
And had someone told you prior to coming to China that they would do this, or you just went on the assumption that you would be able to figure it out once you got there?
Oh, actually, that is an interesting question. Yeah, actually, I didn't have any the plans, like to, you know, borrowing some ID. But when I got to South Korea, when I got to China, I was aware of the, you know, that the Chinese government's stepping up its the crackdown on North Korean defectors at the border area. So, and then I realized, oh, I needed, I have to borrow ID, you know, to go through the route safely, right?
Right.
Without being caught. So right. Actually that worked, right?
And then the route is you go through China and eventually you, what, hop on a boat to South Korea, and that's how it happened? Or what's the rest of your story? How did you get to South Korea eventually?
We had to go to Laos. It's one of the Southeast Asian countries, right? So after I crossing the border, I had to take a bus, which is a long distance bus. Yeah, it was express bus. And then I went to you know, the border city is called the Kunming, which is located just nearby the Laos. So, and then I crossed the border to reach the embassy of South Korea in Laos, right?
Understand.
Yeah, so that's why, you know, I was able to reach there. And then I asked the asylum. And then finally I got to South Korea. It was very risky, but was successful. Yeah.
What was the moment at which you thought to yourself, I've done it? This is going to work. Was it when you finally went into the embassy in Laos?
Yeah. Oh, you mean, could you say that again, please?
Was there a moment at which you realized the defection will work and that you will get to South Korea?
Actually, I didn't have any idea, since I didn't know anything about Laos and any route. Just only I was told by broker, it's going to be okay, but if something happened, like incidents, like being caught, you should say to police of Laos that you are not North Korean, but South Korean. Then you're going to repatriate back to South Korean government or something like that.
Right.
But it happened. The accident happened to us. So we were caught by the Laotian police and was sent to prison. So I was put in jail for, I think, 2 months. And then, luckily, we were released to the embassy of South Korea. And finally, we got to South Korea. Right.
And did you find your sister?
Yeah. Yeah. We met.
So we're talking now in the United States. Looking back on what's happened to you and your journey to getting here, talking to me on this podcast show, how do you view the rest of your life now? And how do you view your former country? I mean, did you get out of defecting what you hoped would happen? And what do you hope will happen in North Korea during your lifetime, if possible?
I think as a North Korean defector who is experienced in North Korea and being aware of what's going on inside North Korea, I think, you know, there is 23 million or 24 million North Korean citizens living in North Korea without any freedom of expression and speaking, even movement. So they don't know even what is human rights is. So I think, providing information to people in North Korea. So if they you know, become aware of what's going on outside world and what is the truth, and if they could able to distinguish between truth and false, so they could choose their own way, and you know, they could have a better life and could achieve the freedom. So I really hope this kind of things are gonna happen in the upcoming future. So yeah, this is my hope.
Are you optimistic about that?
Yeah, I'm not not pessimistic, but you know, it's the people are more likely being aware of outside world by seeing the foreign videos, and also, you know, like a lot of this foreign information actually is being, you know, sent into North Korea by, you know, NGOs and many the people, the international community who are interested in helping North Korean people. So I think it's a hopefully, and it's gonna happen, right? One day, North Koreans able to, you know, choose and their way, and are able to show the world what they are capable of.
Well, Lee, thank you so much for coming on the show. It was really a great honor and privilege to talk to you.
Thanks so much for having me.
Thanks for listening. If you're interested in learning more about the exchange, want to listen to episodes online, or would like to reach out to the show, feel free to visit the show's website at theexchangeshow.com.